information about the grand jury's work on the investigation into the death of Elijah McClain. I think most of you are familiar with Elijah McClain's story. He died following a physical encounter with Aurora police officers and Aurora Fire Rescue paramedics the night of August 24th, 2019. In June 2020, by executive order, the governor appointed me to act as the state's prosecutor, investigate, and if the evidence permits, prosecute potential criminal activity by individuals who caused the death of Elijah McClain. Our department did not seek this investigation. After we were appointed to take on the important responsibility, we took it very seriously. At the time, I said our investigation would be guided by a commitment to the facts, by a thorough and diligent work, and would be worthy of public trust and confidence in our criminal justice system. These remain our guiding principles for this matter. As you know, there was an initial investigation into Mr. McClain's death, which was limited. Our department had the option merely to review the record of that effort or undertake additional fact-finding to inquire further into the events surrounding Mr. McClain's death. We decided to take the latter course because whenever a person dies after an encounter with law enforcement, the community deserves a thorough investigation. Mr. McClain's family deserves it, and justice requires it. As our department conducted its work, it became clear that we needed the grand jury and its enhanced investigative powers to obtain documents and compel testimony from witnesses that would otherwise we'd not be able to obtain using ordinary investigative techniques. Over the last year, our team faced considerable challenges because the statewide grand jury didn't meet for a lengthy period of time on account of the COVID-19 pandemic. In December 2020, we were finally able to engage the statewide grand jury to investigate Mr. McClain's death. On January 8, 2021, my department announced that we had opened this grand jury investigation. That process continued until last Thursday, when the grand jury concluded its work and returned its findings. We are announcing the grand jury's findings made last week today because we needed time to contact Mr. McClain's family, his mother, Shanine McClain, and father, Luane Mosley, and to contact those under investigation for their actions. At the outset, a few points about the statewide grand jury process bear mention. First, a grand jury is made up of impartial citizens who are called from the community to serve. The grand jury is a core part of our criminal justice system. The citizens who participate in this undertaking take their roles and responsibilities very seriously. Those who serve on the statewide grand jury not only are serious and diligent in their work, but they also invest considerable time and effort to serve the public. They deserve our gratitude for their work. Second, under state law, grand jury activities and materials must be kept confidential. What can be disclosed and what I will share today are the relevant facts and circumstances that we are authorized to share. We recognize that many people, including Mr. McClain's family, concerned citizens, members of the media, and others, have had many questions regarding this grand jury process and its activities. Over the course of the process, we had, and we continue to have, a legal and ethical obligation to maintain the confidentiality and integrity of this investigation. We appreciate the public's patience as we conducted and continue to conduct our work. Late last Thursday, after careful and thoughtful deliberation, the grand jury returned a 32-count indictment against Aurora police officers Randy Roedema and Nathan Woodyard, former Aurora police officer Jason Rosenblatt, and Aurora Fire Rescue paramedics Jeremy Cooper and Peter Cichuniec for their alleged conduct on the night of August 24th, 2019, that resulted in the death of Mr. McClain. Each of the five defendants face one count of manslaughter and one count of criminally negligent homicide. Officers Roedema and Rosenblatt also face, each of them, a count of second-degree assault with intent to cause bodily injury and caused serious bodily injury to Mr. McClain. Both also face one count of a crime of violence related to the second-degree assault bodily injury charge. In addition to the manslaughter and criminally negligent homicide charges, paramedics Cooper and Cichuniec also face one count second-degree assault with intent to cause bodily injury and caused bodily injury, one count second-degree assault for recklessly causing serious bodily injury by means of a deadly weapon, ketamine, one count second-degree assault for a purpose other than lawful medical or therapeutic treatment, intentionally causing stupor, unconsciousness, or other physical or mental impairment or injury to Mr. McClain by administering a drug, ketamine, without consent. Cooper and Cichuniec also face two counts of crimes of violence for each of the assault charges. At this moment, my department is filing the indictment in Adams County District Court. The indictment will be unsealed. It is important to remind everyone that a grand jury indictment is a formal accusation based on a determination of probable cause that an individual committed a crime under Colorado law. All defendants are presumed innocent until proven guilty beyond a reasonable doubt. Our department has the solemn duty to prosecute this case. Make no mistake, we recognize that this case will be difficult to prosecute. These types of cases always are. Our goal is to seek justice for Elijah McClain, for his family and friends, and for our state. In so doing, we advance the rule of law and the commitment that everyone is accountable and equal under the law. Many of you will have questions as this case proceeds. We understand that, and we want you to understand that we are limited in what we can say and will do our talking in court. We thank you in advance for your patience as this case goes forward. I want to thank the statewide grand jury for their service. I want to thank our team, our prosecutors, our investigators, and all staff members who worked hard on this case for over a year and will continue to do so. We're here today because Elijah McClain is not here, and he should be. He was a son, a nephew, a brother, and a friend. When he died, he was only 23 years old. He had his whole life ahead of him. And his family and his friends must now go on and live without him. His death is a loss to all of us. Elijah McClain's memory will live on as a blessing to all of us. After his death, Colorado continues to lead on law enforcement accountability. And in a separate civil investigation, my department is looking into whether the city of Aurora, specifically Aurora Fire and Aurora Police, have a pattern and practice of violating the civil rights of their community members. That matter is still ongoing. We will announce our findings when that investigation comes to a close. By working to build trust in law enforcement and working to elevate what safe and effective policing looks like, we will advance public safety, and we will honor the profession's commitment to serve all Coloradans fairly and responsibly. Thank you.
All right, Attorney General there speaking. Big development here and major charges coming to officers and paramedics involved in the Elijah McClain death that happened back in August of 2018, I believe.
Yeah, 2019. We just learned moments ago from the state attorney general that all five, so the police officers and paramedics, are facing one count of manslaughter. But in total here, yeah. 32 count indictment against the police officers, former as well as former paramedics. With the fire department. So a major update this morning, and now, as he mentioned, you know, this is all just charges at this point and innocent until proven guilty.
Yeah, charges of manslaughter, criminally negligent homicide, major charges. Let's get to Attorney David Lane. He's a civil rights attorney. Obviously, you were listening on this, learning the details as we were learning the details. First and foremost, these charges, I mean, 32 counts, three police officers, two paramedics, charges like manslaughter are very, very serious charges. What makes you think they decided that they had enough evidence, they had a cause to place these charges in this case?
Well, keep in mind, my office represents Luane Mosley, who is Elijah McClain's father, right, primarily through Maury Newman, my law partner. We are very familiar with the facts of this case. Unlike Dennis Chauvin in Minneapolis, who was indicted for an intentional crime he intended to kill, no one has really got any evidence that these officers and paramedics intended to kill Elijah McClain. Manslaughter charges generally mean they were acting recklessly. And I think that's an appropriate charge in this case, because clearly they were acting recklessly at the very least. Criminal negligence is one step below that, meaning they should have seen a risk and they just ignored it. So these are very serious charges. Actually, ironically, the assault charges may carry mandatory Department of Corrections time if they go down on those assault charges. It'll be very interesting, because the paramedics are basically going to say that, you know, and I'm projecting now, it's the police chokeholds that killed him. The police are going to possibly take a position that, no, it was the ketamine that killed him. They're going to be pointing fingers at each other, which is a prosecutor's dream scenario. But if a jury believes they were all acting together in a reckless manner, they're all going down. So there will never be justice in this case, because Elijah McClain is not coming back. But there may be some accountability here, and that is definitely a step in the right direction.
We heard the state attorney general talking about intentionally causing super unconsciousness by administering a drug without consent. So he's talking about ketamine. So for people at home who don't know much about ketamine, did those paramedics, who did they need consent from to use it at the time?
That is a very gray area, and this indictment shows that it's a gray area. You know, I mean, you can't just be walking down the street and all of a sudden somebody jumps out of an ambulance or a fire truck and sticks you with ketamine. They have to have some reasonable cause to believe that you are in some extreme emotional distress and your system can't take it, and then they inject people to calm them down against their will. Many states have now banned the use of ketamine in this fashion, because it just seems so over the top to give the government authority to just jump on somebody and shoot them up with a drug against their will. But I mean, the contra to that is, like, if you're lying on the street unconscious and you need a shot of adrenaline to stay alive, whether you have consent or not, they're going to give it to you. So it just depends on the circumstances. But these circumstances were pretty clear that they gave him a shot of ketamine because that's what they do. Not that he needed it, but hey, we've got it, we're here, let's do it. And they gave him a big overdose, and that was a contributing factor to his death.
And all of these facts or questions, if you will be sorted out in court. As the attorney general pointed out, these are accusations. Everyone's presumed innocent until proven guilty. And so we will be tracking that closely. David Lane, we got to go. Civil rights attorney, certainly appreciate your perspective as this big announcement just came down minutes ago.
Let's get right to Fox 31's Lori Jane Gleeha. She is live and, you know, has been a huge part of this investigation. And covering this has been on it since the beginning. Lori?
Yeah, guys, the big headline here is that the grand jury finished up their investigation last week and has announced a 32-count indictment against the police officers and the paramedics that were involved in this. The indictment includes manslaughter charges and criminally negligent homicide for the three police officers who encountered McClain initially, as well as the two paramedics who made the decision to give him ketamine, to sedate him with ketamine. All of these individuals also face additional charges, including assault charges. But big headline here again, 32-count indictment. This grand jury was announced back in January. There's been some delays in them meeting to discuss this case. The attorney general has been in charge of presenting the evidence to them over the span of this last several months. And he is now currently also engaged in a simultaneous investigation into the patterns and practices at the Aurora Police Department to determine whether or not they have a pattern and practice of civil rights violations. That investigation continues. He's not ready to announce the results of that. But right now they're filing the indictment in court. We'll be able to have that be unsealed. And then we'll be able to read all of the details of how the grand jury came to this conclusion.
Talk about the investigation into the department itself. You wonder if there would be some sort of sanctions or charges even against the department itself.
Absolutely. I mean, there could be lots of things that happen. Generally, when police departments are investigated like this, there's some sort of negotiation that happens or some sort of people that can come in and help them. You know, Aurora Police Department is aware of many of the issues that they've had over the last several years. They've had lots of different civil rights complaints against them. So there's a lot more to the story that remains to be seen. But again, today, multiple count indictment against the officers and the paramedics involved.
All right, Lori Jane, thank you. Major update today. So we are on it with all of the information, background on the case, also on our Fox 31 News app.
We're talking to all the players involved, the people involved in this case. We'll have much more coverage coming up for you. The Fox 31 News at 11. We'll see you.